sisters.
Yeah.
So as Pat said, this is the talk by Elder Sabin, Hallmarks of Happiness. And in this talk, he gives us practical tips on how to be happy. Who here would benefit from having more happiness in your life?
I know definitely I would.
We're going to start with Elder Sabin's introduction to his talk.
Push the red button this way.
Well, on a business trip several years ago, I found myself seated next to a man from the Netherlands. I was eager to visit with him since I had served in Belgium and the Netherlands as a young missionary. As we became acquainted, he gave me his business card with the unique job title of Professor of Happiness. I commented on his amazing profession and asked him what a professor of happiness did. He said he taught people how to have a happy life by establishing meaningful relationships and goals. I replied, "That's wonderful. But what if you could also teach how those relationships can continue beyond the grave and answer other questions of the soul, such as what is the purpose of life? How can we overcome our weaknesses? And where do we go after we die?" He admitted that it would be amazing if we had the answers to those questions, and I was pleased to share with him that we did. Today I would like to review a few essential principles for true happiness that seem to elude so many in this confusing world, where many things are interesting, but few are truly important.
I love that quote. In this world, many things are interesting, but few are truly important. That is definitely the case where, and I talk about this a little bit later in my lesson, but where people value so much things that entertain and are just really interesting, but not always the things that matter. Anyway, so he goes on to share his five observations, his five essential principles for happiness. And this is an overview of the talk. The first is build upon the foundation of Jesus Christ. Remember that we are sons and daughters of a loving Heavenly Father. Remember the worth of a soul. Maintain an eternal perspective. And you will never be happier than you are grateful. All right, so the first is build upon the foundation of Christ. Who would like to read this brief quote?
This is a sure foundation, a foundation whereon if men build, they cannot fall. Doing so prepares us for the challenges of life.
Thank you. How do we build on a foundation of Jesus Christ? Open-ended question. No wrong answer. Well, there are wrong answers, but
by reading the scriptures.
Scriptures, definitely. Anyone else?
I'll just make a few things, habits. As to what you do in the morning, and prayers, and people that we can help.
The habits, that's one that I need to work on for sure, because my morning routine usually goes roll out of bed, get Matthew started on his schoolwork, and then take a nap on the couch. So, you know, we all have things we need to work out. Did you have something, Pat?
I was just going to say, I have images in my house. As a reminder, in my hallway, my second daughter, for I think it was Christmas or my birthday, I can't remember, she sketched an 11 by 14 image of Christ, and I have that in my hallway, so I get to see that every day, and it's a good reminder that he is important.
That's cool. That's a treasure.
Many years ago, I went to a summer scout camp with our son, Justin. As the activities got underway, he excitedly announced that he and his friends wanted to earn the archery merit badge. Doing so required the boys to pass a short written test and hit a target with their arrows. My heart sank. At the time, Justin was quite frail due to cystic fibrosis, a disease he had been battling since birth. I wondered if he could pull the bow back far enough to send the arrow to the target. As he and his friends left for the archery class, I silently prayed that he would not be humiliated by the experience. A couple of anxious hours later, I saw him coming up the path toward me with a big smile. "Dad," he exclaimed, "I got the merit badge. I got a bullseye. It was on the target next to mine, but I hit a bullseye." He had pulled the bow back with all his might and let the arrow fly, unable to control its trajectory. How grateful I am for that understanding archery instructor who never said, "Sorry, wrong target." Rather, upon seeing Justin's obvious limitations and earnest effort, he kindly responded, "Good job." That is how it will be for us if we do our very best to follow Christ and his prophets in spite of our limitations. If we come unto him by keeping our covenants and repenting of our sins, we will joyfully hear our Savior's commendation, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant."
In spite of our limitations. Who here has limitations? Anyone? Yes, definitely. I like how when we talk, when prophets and apostles and you know, Leona articles and everything, they talk about keeping covenants and repenting of our sins. They never say, "Be perfect." They never say, "Just don't sin." I mean, of course, they talk about being righteous and keeping the commandments and stuff, but it's always repenting of our sins. The Lord knows that we will be making mistakes. The Lord knows we have weaknesses and limitations and temptations, and that there will be mistakes and there will be sins. The important thing is repenting of them and doing our best. That little boy did his very best. He gave everything that he had. And he didn't get the result that was technically required, the perfection of a bullseye in his target, but he was rewarded for giving his best effort. And we will be too.
Okay.
Stuff to discuss. Who wants to read this?
I bear my witness of the divinity of the Savior of the world and his representative of love and power to heal, to strengthen and lift us when we are earnestly striving to come unto him and to come and tell him.
It should say unto him. That was a typo on my part.
Sorry. And the Savior has defeated death, disease, and sin, has provided a way for unlimited perfection if we will follow him with all of our hearts.
And there's a scripture to go with that. Who would like to read John 16:33?
I bear you my witness.
Oh, we got this read already. We need the scripture. John 16:33. I can read it. It's my absolute favorite scripture, so I don't mind reading. "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." I should have come up with like some specific questions for this, but I was just like, class participation, but they can figure it out themselves, apparently. Does anyone have any thoughts about this, about what we've read?
Eventually, as we keep trying to strive to improve ourselves, that we'll overcome tribulations. Now, I'm like you. I get up in the morning, I roll out of bed, say my prayers, listen to my scriptures, and sit in my chair the rest of the day, you know, beating and instead of cleaning. And it's one of those things that I need also to overcome. And it's just, it's so easy for me to not to get out of my bad routine and then get into a good routine. Mm-hmm. So it takes time.
Habits can be really hard to overcome. The not cleaning habit is definitely one that I also need to work on overcoming. But Christ has overcome the world. He's overcome all of it. He knows how it feels to sit and craft in a filthy house, the way that some of us know how to do. And he knows how it feels to be trying your hardest and still feel like you're coming up short, because he experienced all of that during the atonement. And he defeated that. And so when we turn to him, he gives us a way to defeat it as well. And there's also this quote: there is no way we can move with the crowd and also toward Jesus. There's a couple of scriptures here. Matthew 6:24. Who can read that?
No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold on to the one and despise the other. Yea, he cannot serve God and mammon.
Thank you. So we can either serve God or we can follow the crowd and do what the world would have us do. It's the basic gist of that scripture. And then Moroni 10:32.
Yea, come unto Christ and be perfected in him, and obey your, and deny yourselves of all ungodliness, and if ye shall deny yourselves of all ungodliness, and love God with all your might, mind, and strength, then his grace is sufficient for you, that by his grace ye may be perfect in Christ, and if the grace of God, and if by the grace of God ye are perfect in Christ, ye can no wise deny the power of God.
Thank you. So,
I'm blind. Why do you think I'm talking about wonderful?
Any thoughts about that?
I was just reading the part there. The Savior of the world and his redemptive love and power to heal, strengthen, and lift us when we are earnestly striving to come unto him. What better person to be on our team to help us every day to, if we realize the power and the strength and that he has for us individually. That's amazing.
Yeah. Thank you for your thoughts on that. Second, remember that we are sons and daughters of a loving Heavenly Father. So the first is built on the foundation of Jesus Christ. Second, we're sons and daughters of Heavenly Father.
Several years ago, on a flight home from a church assignment, Sister Saban and I found ourselves seated directly behind a very large man who had a big, angry face tattooed on the back of his bald head, as well as the number 439. When we landed, I said, "Excuse me, sir, do you mind if I ask the significance of the number tattooed on the back of your head?" I didn't ever ask about the angry face. He said, that's me. That's who I am. I own that territory. 219. 439 was the actual number on his head. So I was surprised he got it wrong since it was so important to him. I thought how sad it was that this man's identity and self-esteem were based on a number associated with a gang territory. I thought to myself, this tough-looking man was once somebody's little boy once, who still needed to feel valued and to belong. If only he knew who he really was and to whom he really belonged, for we have all been bought with a price.
I thought that was an interesting story. You know, he put so much store in his gang territory. That's who he was. And just before telling that story, Elder Sabin says, knowing and trusting that we're sons and daughters of a loving Heavenly Father, knowing and trusting this reality changes everything. I wonder how that man's life would change if he was able to put that put his perception of who he was in knowing that he's a son of God, rather than this is my gang territory. There is a wise line in a song from the film The Prince of Egypt that states, look at your life through heaven's eyes. As the knowledge of our divine lineage and eternal potential sinks deep into our souls, we will be able to view life as a purposeful, unfolding adventure to learn and grow from, even as we see through glass darkly for a short season. I really like how it talks about life is a purposeful, unfolding adventure. We're not here just to float through, just to sludge through until we die and it's over. That's not what life is about. Life is about, it's purposeful. We have a purpose here on earth. And as members of the church, we know what that purpose is. It's to test us, to see if we'll follow the commandments and to qualify for eternal life. And it's an adventure, and we're here to learn, to grow. How can you look at your life through heaven's eyes? What can you do to adjust your perspective so that you're seeing yourself the way that the Lord sees you?
When I have to think about how can you look at your life through heaven's eyes, the best that I can identify with is to live like Christ. For me, this is something I teach my children and my grandchildren, you know, because to me that is like a foundation for what I can become of me, become of ourselves. And that is the best example to me that I can do, because to live like Christ-like is just, is so profound, so deep, so wonderful. It is all kind of feelings. It's all kind of reasons. He is our teacher. He is our beginning. None that is really our end. It's a continuum. So, that's my
like knowing that you're a child of God means you're Christ's sibling. You know, Christ is your brother. He is our brother, and we can be like him.
Mm-hmm.
How can seeing yourself through Heavenly Father's eyes bring you happiness? I can share a little bit about this for myself. This is one thing that I struggle greatly with. You can ask my therapist, it's ridiculous. I have really low self-esteem, and my thoughts towards myself are very harsh and critical. all the time. And it's hard for me to see any other view besides that harsh, critical person inside me that's saying, you're a terrible person, you don't deserve anything good. But if I try really, really hard and pray and really focus on it, then I can get a glimpse of that love that Heavenly Father has for me as His daughter. And it's not easy. My brain tries to reject it because of the depression and the brain chemicals that are all out of whack and stuff. But when I am able to see myself that way, it's so much more peaceful and so much less painful. So just knowing that someone out there, not just someone, but Heavenly Father, sees me as someone who's worth His love. And knowing that my brain is lying to me, and there is goodness and you know, lovability in me, it can bring me joy despite my mental and emotional limitations. Now, because it talks, it mentions the song, Look at Your Life Through Heaven's Eyes, and because I love this movie and this song, I found a Tabernacle Choir version of it, and it's with the original voice actor, and so we have to listen to it because, speaking of things that make me happy, this song, it's powerful, it's joyful, and it's a happy, wonderful song. So we're going to listen to it.
Join the dance.
heaven's eyes and not the limited eyes of the world or your mental issues, and you can be much happier. Third, always remember the worth of a soul. And here is a handful of scriptures that talk about the worth of a soul. Who would like to read Doctrine and Covenants 18:10?
Remember, the worth of souls is great in the sight of God.
John 13:34.
A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I as I have loved you, that ye also love one another.
Thank you. Matthew 25:40. Yes.
And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me.
Thank you. Proverbs 3:27.
Withhold not good from them to whom it is due, when it is in the power of thine hand to do it.
And Ephesians 4:32.
And be ye kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you.
Thank you. And this is just a small handful of scriptures that are of verses. There are verses all throughout the scriptures that talk about how we should treat those around us. And that remind us that the worth of the soul is great, and that's not just our soul, but that's the soul of every person on the earth, everyone who has ever lived, everyone who lives now and ever will live. Elder Saban says, we will never regret being too kind. In God's eyes, kindness is synonymous with greatness. Part of being kind is being forgiving and non-judgmental.
I believe this part that you just read. I believe that part that you just read is very wonderful. Mm-hmm. It has so much meaning, practically, in the whole sentence. And I hope I can always remember that. We should always remember that every single day of our life. Because it has so much meaning.
Yeah. We will never regret being too kind.
Exactly. Thank you.
Yes. I'm reading a book right now by Steve Young called God's Law of Love. And in it, at one point he's telling us, so that we're not judgmental or anything, to look at everyone as if they're eternal beings. Mm-hmm. And I just thought that, you know, when you look at someone thinking of them in that way, you kind of soften your heart and are not quite as judgmental.
Yeah. I have found myself sometimes praying to be able to see a person that the way that Heavenly Father sees them. Because sometimes, as a mortal, I do feel a little judgy. And it helps. Heavenly Father will help us to feel even just a portion of the love that He has for that person. And it can be eye-opening and kind of freeing to just let go of that judgment and to see another person the way that Heavenly Father sees them. Elder Saban was full of stories, and here's another one. Kind of like this one, it's fun.
Many years ago, our young family was going to see a movie for family home evening. We were all in the van except for one of our sons and my wife, Valerie. It was dark outside, and as our son threw open the door and ran toward the car, he accidentally kicked what he thought was our cat on the porch. Unfortunately for our son and my wife, who was right behind him, it was not our cat, but rather a very unhappy skunk who left the note. We all returned to the house, and they both showered and washed their hair with tomato juice, the supposed sure remedy to eliminate skunk odor. By the time they had cleaned up and changed their clothes, we were all desensitized to any odor, so we decided we were okay to go to the movie after all. Once we were seated at the back of the theater, one by one, the people around us suddenly decided to go out to get popcorn. When they came back, however, no one returned to their original seat. We have laughed as we recalled that experience. But what if all of our sins had an odor? What if we could smell dishonesty, lust, envy, or pride? With our weaknesses revealed, we would hopefully be a little more considerate and careful of others, and likewise they with us as we make the needed changes in our lives. I actually love the smell of tobacco in church because it indicates someone is trying to change. They need our welcoming arms around them.
So I've thought about that. You know, what would I smell like? And, you know, if each of us had our, you know, sins on display for everyone to see, we would probably be a lot more forgiving and non-judgmental and considerate to others when we see their sins. I had a thought come to me, but it went away, as so often happens. But I guess I don't need to share it. All right. President Russell M. Nelson has wisely said, "One of the easiest ways to identify a true follower of Jesus Christ is how compassionately that person treats other people." You know, we all know or have heard of people who claim to be, you know, very strong Christian and righteous follower of Christ, but treat others like dirt, or treat respectfully only people that they see as being their equals or higher than them, but the people that they don't think are good enough, they just, you know, look down their nose at them. And that's not a true follower of Christ.
Yeah. Well, my granddaughter was living in Moroni, and she was going to school. The kids at the school treated her badly because she wasn't a member of the church. Mm-hmm. And I felt so bad, and I had to keep convincing her that not all members of the church would act in such a way, and that wasn't the true Christian way. And you know, we don't, I think we need to be more aware how we act toward people who aren't members of the church, to accept them, because Heavenly Father said to love one another. He didn't put any exceptions. He didn't say except if they're same religion as us. He didn't say because they're section, because they're same color as us. He put no exceptions,
yeah.
And that's the way we should be.
Yeah. As disciples of Jesus Christ, we are asked to trust Heavenly Father and our Savior and not attempt to replace them. Jesus Christ knows everyone's imperfections perfectly and will judge them perfectly. So how can we keep our focus on trusting Heavenly Father and Jesus rather than replacing them in judging other people? I like that phrase, you know, not attempt to replace them. So how do we do that?
Just by remembering we're not perfect either. You know, I always tell my kids, I'm not one to cast any stones. And it's like I said, the first person without sin, cast the first stone. So
yeah.
I tell my kids, I ain't casting any stones because I'm far from being perfect.
Yeah, kind of goes back to, you know, what we were talking about before. If people could smell everybody else's sins, you know, the world would be really smelly. It would not be good. But just remember that it's not our place.
I was given an object lesson once where we were handed a piece of paper and said, you know, write out the one problem that's really been bothering you today or this week. And then, so we all did that, and we folded it up and put it in a bowl. And then the instructor said, now, come pick out someone else's problems. And none of us wanted to do that because we understood what we were dealing with, and we didn't necessarily want their issues. But I think that comes into being judgmental. We don't know what they're going through. We don't know how their week's been. We don't know if they're having a hard time or if someone has been mean to them. That's not our place, but our Father in Heaven knows what they're dealing with. Mm-hmm. We should just love them if we can.
Yeah. There's a quote somewhere along the lines of, everyone you meet is fighting a silent battle. And so we need to remember that and be compassionate and loving and remember that their soul is worth everything to Heavenly Father, just like ours is. Fourth, maintain an eternal perspective. Elder Sabin says, our Father's plan stretches into the eternities. It is easy to focus on the here and now and forget the hereafter. So I found this little visual where man's view is the present. Maybe a little bit into the past, but not really into the future. We can maybe guess what the future is going to be. Like, you know, well, like it says it's going to rain tomorrow and I have an assignment due, so I can foresee that much into my future. But God's view, everything. He sees past, present, future, and it's all one to him. And so he has an eternal perspective, and we need to remember that and try to have a similar perspective. We may not be able to see it all, but we know that, I feel like I'm rambling and I don't know where I'm going. We know that Heavenly Father sees into the future, you know, sees everything, and we need to trust him. Another story from Elder Sabin.
I was taught this lesson powerfully a number of years ago by our then 16-year-old daughter, Jennifer. She was about to have a double lung transplant where the 5 diseased lobes of her lungs would be completely removed and replaced by 2 healthy, smaller lobes donated by 2 amazing Christ-like friends. It was a very high-risk procedure. Yet the night before her surgery, Jennifer almost preached to me with all of her 90 pounds, saying, don't worry, Dad. Tomorrow I will wake up with new lungs, or I will wake up in a better place. Either way will be great. That is faith. That is eternal perspective. Seeing life from an eternal vantage point provides clarity, comfort, courage, and hope. After the surgery, when the long-awaited day came to remove the breathing tube and turn off the ventilator that had been helping Jennifer breathe, we anxiously waited to see if her 2 smaller lobes would work. When she took her first breath, she immediately started crying. Seeing our concern, she quickly exclaimed, it's just so good to breathe. Ever since that day, I have thanked Heavenly Father morning and night for my ability to breathe. We are surrounded by innumerable blessings that we can easily take for granted if we are not mindful. Conversely, when nothing is expected and everything is appreciated, life becomes magical.
So I like that he says, seeing life from an eternal vantage point provides clarity, comfort, courage, and hope. This young woman didn't know if the surgery would work. She didn't know if she was even going to survive the surgery, if the lungs would work. She didn't know what was going to happen, but she had an eternal perspective that told her it doesn't matter what happens because everything's going to be okay. She trusted Heavenly Father and just knew that no matter what happened, he was there for her and it would be for the best. President Nelson has said, each new morning is a gift from God. Even the air we breathe is a loving loan from him. He preserves us from day to day and supports us from one moment to another. Therefore, our first noble deed of the morning should be a humble prayer of gratitude. And that leads into the fifth principle. You will never be happier than you are grateful. Who would like to read this?
The Lord declared, and he who receives all things with thankfulness shall be made glorious. Perhaps this is because gratitude gives birth to a multitude of our virtues.
Multitude of other virtues. I like that. Those who are thankful shall be made glorious. I think it would be pretty awesome to be glorious. And then, if someone could read this. Yes.
How our awfulness would change.
Awareness.
Huh?
Awareness.
Sorry. How our awareness, our awareness would change if every morning we woke up with our only blessing, the blessings we are grateful for the night before.
So here's a fun little exercise. What blessings would you have today if you only had what you were grateful for last night? Does anyone want to share?
I think we take a lot of things for granted. I mean, I did up until I, you know, took in a couple of homeless people, and I realized they were without beds, showers, toilet, you know, and just food every day. And I realized, well, I'm, you know, need to be grateful for the fact I can get up and take a shower, or I can get up and use the bathroom, or I've got a comfortable bed to sleep on. I've got warm covers to keep me warm. I've got a house and a shelter. You know, and I think we often do. We do take these things for granted because they're there every day. And I don't know. I'm trying desperately to be more and more grateful for what we have. And it's sometimes hard because we do take it for granted.
Yeah. If I were to wake up with what I was grateful for last night and without the things that I wasn't grateful for, I would be homeless. Because my house is messy and I was not feeling thankful for it last night. It's an important reminder to feel grateful for the blessings that we have. there have been multiple studies and research showing that cultivating gratitude can help you and others. And I found this visual about that, I'm going to read through it because it might be a bit small for some of you. So it can help you be happier, you experience greater life satisfaction and have less symptoms of depression and anxiety, have more energy so you can engage in healthier activities and because you sleep longer and wake up refreshed. It will help you be more resilient. You can grow from trauma and protect against burnout. Have stronger relationships. You'll feel more loved, supported, committed, and satisfied, and feel more valued. It can boost motivation and performance. It can help you work harder and feel more fulfilled, and makes it easier to identify and solve problems. And gratitude can help you build character, makes you more likely to offer help, and be more trusting and trustworthy. So there are a lot of scientifically proven benefits to being grateful. Failure to appreciate our blessings can result in a sense of dissatisfaction, which can rob us of the joy and happiness that gratitude engenders. Those in the great and spacious building entice us to look beyond the mark, thereby missing the mark entirely. And then earlier in his talk and earlier in my lesson, Elder Sabin mentions that in this confusing world, many things are interesting, but few are truly important. The world would have us focus on being entertained, always seeking what is interesting, newer, better, never happy with what we have. But that is not the way to happiness. If you look at social media influencers, they're always saying, you know, you got to try this new thing or this new life hack, you know, and I've tried this product and it's so much better than what I was doing before. You know, there's always that push to have something new, something different, and to not be satisfied with what you have.
Yeah. I believe also one of the best ways to be happy is to be humble.
Yes, humility is really important. You know, we were talking about people who feel like they're better than other people. You can't be happy if you're feeling that way. So this is not the way to happiness. So how can we find true happiness? And this is how Elder Sabin wraps up his talk in sharing what we can do to find true happiness.
I promise you that if we build our lives upon the foundation of Jesus Christ, value our true identity as sons and daughters of God, remember the worth of a soul, maintain an eternal perspective, and gratefully appreciate our many blessings, especially Christ's invitation to come unto him, we can find the true happiness we seek during this mortal adventure. Life will still have its challenges, but we will be able to better face each with a sense of purpose and peace because of the eternal truths we understand and live by. I bear you my witness of the reality of God, our loving Father, and of his beloved Son, Jesus Christ. I also testify of living prophets, seers, and revelators. What a blessing it is to receive the counsel of heaven through them. As the Savior clearly stated, whether by my own voice or by the voice of my servants, it is the same. In the sacred name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen.
And I would like to conclude in the same vein, following the commandments, foundation of Christ, see yourself the way that Heavenly Father sees you, as a son or the daughter of Jesus Christ, or of God. Remember the worth of the souls, not just your own, but those around you, maintaining an eternal perspective and being grateful. And those things will help us, despite the problems of mortality, to find joy and happiness in this life and in the life to come. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.